everybody, I am Michael Davis. Welcome to Bone to Pick, and I am really pleased today to have the opportunity to sit down with one of the great trumpet players anywhere in the world today. He's one of the finest musicians that I have the opportunity to work with on a regular basis here in New York, and he's a super good friend of mine. We've worked together for many, many years, and this is really looking forward to today. We're talking about none other than the great Tony Cadlick. Tony grew up in Binghamton, New York. He attended the New England Conservatory of Music in Boston, also the Manhattan School of Music here in New York City. He cut his teeth with the Buddy Rich Band right out of school, also spent some time with Woody Herman, toured for many years with Frank Sinatra, Barbara Streisand. He's recorded and performed with everybody from Michael Jackson to James Taylor. He's been a charter member of the Maria Schneider Jazz Orchestra. He's played with the Boston Pops, and just hundreds of recordings and Broadway shows here in New York. And I have to say, I think he's probably the busiest brass player in town, and I would include any of the brass instruments. So, Tony, thanks so much for taking time out of your schedule and spending some time with us today and talking about your career.
Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
Why don't we jump right in and talk about, you know, kind of the early years and maybe share some of the things that might have happened that led you to the trumpet and maybe some of the early influences on you as a musician and a trumpet player.
Sure. I actually started playing drums when I was 10 years old in elementary school. And for some reason, I eventually graduated. I don't know if you can call it graduated, but I moved on to the euphonium. And then I played that for about a year. And I didn't actually play trumpet until I was 14, so maybe, I don't know, 8th grade. I didn't really come from a musical household, but in my high school, there were several people that are actually musicians today, professional musicians. Dina DeRose, John Hollenbeck, Steve Davis, Chris Jensen, Tom Dempsey, great guitar player. It was interesting. I didn't have a big record collection, but Steve Davis, who we both know, his father had an unbelievably great record collection. So the first time I heard Clark Terry and Freddie Hubbard and Miles Davis was actually at Steve's house. So we would kind of feed off each other and pass each other. After a while, we'd pass each other, you know, cassette tapes and, hey, check this out. And Dina would be like, hey, check out a Hank Jones. And, you know, John would be, oh, check out, you know, Philly Joe or whatever. So it was actually a really nice, nurturing environment to be in, to be in a high school where there were so many professional musicians.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, great stuff. I mean, I must have been great with you and Steve, and Steve's one of my favorite musicians and trombone players. That's quite a brass talent. Yeah. Beginnings of the brass talent that was coming forward. Maybe talk a little bit about your time at New England, and I know I want to get to the Buddy years and all that, but what made you go to New England, and how was your experience there?
It was very good. It was interesting because I came from a small town of Binghamton, and my whole life I wanted to go to Eastman School of Music because I was in upstate New York and it was close by, and I auditioned there, and I got on the waiting list. I actually wasn't like accepted right away, so I was of course crestfallen. But I auditioned at New England and a couple other schools and got in there. And there was actually more scholarship money at New England, and it was actually a good fit for me because it was a bigger city. Binghamton was very small, and Boston was kind of a nice stepping stone to New York. So I was there for maybe 2.5 years, and I played in the orchestra, and I played in the wind ensemble and the jazz ensemble. I started writing there. I studied a little bit with Pat Hollenbeck, and I actually enjoyed my time in Boston very much. I think it's a great stepping stone city for me at that time, and it continues to be a great brass city.
Yeah, that's very cool. I mean, I know as having gone to Eastman, I kind of always wished I had gone to one of the Boston schools only because it's such a great town, so prolific and fruitful, and really happy my own son is there in Boston now and already just really taken to it. So I think it's a great words of advice there for people as well, and in addition to your own experiences. Well, we among the many things that we share in common, I think our both of our first kind of major jobs were with the late great Buddy Rich, and for everybody who knows the speech tapes and everything else, they're all true. It all happened, and it was funny stuff. But it was a great thing, I think, and I want to get your take on it, but I know for me it really felt like an amazing experience to go play every night under this, you know, kind of intense environment and really apply everything that we got in school. So I was just curious if you could talk about, you know, what that was like, just, you know, starting off with him and what your feelings were at that time.
Well, I think, let's see, I joined in January of 86, and I'd already, at this point, I'd already heard the tapes, and I was scared out of my mind, first of all. Everyone would kind of fluff, oh, buddy, yeah, he's just blowing off steam. But I was terrified. I was, you know, at that point, 21 years old. I didn't have a lot of pressure in that I was playing fourth trumpet, so I could kind of hide. But Buddy knew, he had this way of knowing, like, if he wanted to kick your butt, he knew exactly what chart to call that had a fourth trumpet thing, and he was good like that. So it was stressful, but it was just like to see someone play with so much energy and passion. And at that point, maybe, what, 66 years old, I think? I mean, the energy he had and the time and just the, you know, the exuberance he had for music was rubbed off. It was beautiful. And even though we were kind of scared of him, we were also, you know, incredibly respectful. And we couldn't believe, you know, he would go out. His feeling anyway was that I'm 66 and I'm going out and I'm giving 110% every night. And you guys are, what, 20 years old, and you should be giving at least that much. So it was great. I very much enjoyed it. I met a lot of good friends that I still, you know, speak to today. Greg Gisbert was on the band when I was on. Bob Bowlby, lead alto player. Eric Miyashiro was the lead trumpet player. Rick Stepton came out and played lead trombone for a while. Jim Martin, bass trombone player. And folks that I'm kind of in touch with sporadically. But it was a wonderful experience, and I'm glad I had it. I was only on for about 4 months because my parents were not wild about me blowing off school and going.
Funny how that happens.
Yeah. In fact, I took a couple lessons with Bobby Shue the year before I went out. And there was word that I might get called for the band, and my parents were very nervous, and they talked to Bobby. They flew out and heard some concerts in L.A. when I was playing out there with the Disneyland All-American College Band. And so they said to Bobby, geez, what are we going to do? He wants to be a musician. Bobby said, well, let him be a musician. Let him try it. So Bobby was very cool. He calmed him down and said, it'll be fine. Buddy's, you know, it'll be a good experience for him if he gets called. And sure enough, I got called, and my parents were like, well, where are you going to go? What are you going to do? What town are you going to go to? I said, I don't know. I'm going to meet the bus at the Hotel Edison and go, you know. So that's what happened. And, you know, so I spent 4 months there, and then I decided, you know what, I should probably finish my degree. And so I went back to school at a different school.
Yeah, that's great stuff. I couldn't agree more. I mean, I think seeing the intensity and the passion that Buddy had, I mean, he just brought it every night. And you're right, I mean, it really rubs off on you. And I wish we'd had an opportunity to be on that band together. It would have been a lot of fun. Actually, I'm probably not for you at that time, but physically, I'm sure you were ready to play lead. But I would have loved to have heard you play lead on that band as well. And that would have been a great connection with Buddy and you on that. Well, let's talk a little bit about, then from there you went back to New York and resumed your studies at Manhattan School of Music then to finish up your degree?
Yeah, well, I actually hadn't even been to New York at that point. I left New England to go with Buddy, and then I decided that I didn't want to go back to New England. I thought at that point I was ready for New York, and so I auditioned for Manhattan School of Music, and I got in, and so I spent the next 3 years there. And it was the same as New England, really. I met a lot of great friends that I still, you know, work with on a daily basis at Manhattan. The teachers were wonderful. Continued my writing thing at Manhattan a little bit. Had some charts played with the big band, and it was a nice transition to New York, because I was still going to school, so I didn't really feel that pressure like you have to make a living immediately. I kind of felt like, well, I'm still a student. So actually, by the time I got out of Manhattan, I was kind of making my own way. So by 1989, when I graduated finally with a bachelor's degree, I was in a place where I was starting to get into the work scene a little bit.
So. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that always seems like a cool thing about going to school in New York, is it kind of gives you like a bit of a soft landing and getting going and whatnot. Well, I think the first gig that you and I kind of intersected on in a very meaningful way was with Frank Sinatra, and there's so much positive that came out of that and so many great experiences that you and I shared together. But maybe you could just talk in a very general way or more specifically, whatever you prefer, but what your impression was looking back on that now of working with the great Frank Sinatra and what those years were like for you.
Well, it was amazing. It was, I think I started maybe a little after you. I think I was maybe 1991. When I had been at Manhattan, I'd studied with Lou Soloff, and I was playing for him, and Lou said, now the way you play, you need to play lead trumpet with Frank Sinatra someday. That sounds like something that you would be, and oddly enough, it came to pass a little bit, because Buddy Childers was the lead player, but he would pass some charts, and so I kind of got my feet wet. Musically, it might still be the highlight of my life, mm-hmm. just to play those charts, Don Costa and Billy Byers and all those great writers, Nelson Riddle. It's such great material, and you know, I don't think there was one night where I didn't get goosebumps. You know, even though Sinatra was older then, he still had the passion. There were still hints of like the young Sinatra and complete greatness, and the band was incredibly swinging, and you know, a lot of good friends that mm-hmm. that still remain friends today from that. And it was pretty much my dream gig, and I'm sorry that you know it ended after. It was 3.5 years, I think, for me, and even that was too short. I could still do it today.
Yeah, I know we've talked about it many times. What we would give to go. Okay, let's do a week in Atlantic City with the old man, old man, as we called him, and everybody referred to him as. But I totally agree, and really great point you're making about all the arrangers. I mean, I think in reading various accounts from all these great arrangers, Nelson Riddle in particular, I think whenever Sinatra called, they all, you know, completely brought their A game, and you could tell, and I don't think there'll ever be another collection of arrangements that are all great. I mean, it did seem like no matter what set they called that night, it was going to be a great, great show. So I feel the same way you do. I wish it had gone on longer. It was great stuff. Well, let's fast forward a little bit to you coming to New York. You've ascended to, the busiest guy in town these days. But that didn't happen overnight, of course. Maybe you could talk a little bit about some of the important, maybe pivotal gigs that happened along the way. I know there's been so many, and you've worked with everybody under the sun. But are there any that kind of jump out at you that helped you kind of launch up to the next level as it went along?
Yeah, I mean, there's several. There's so many, and it's interesting. You can pretty much every gig I do, I can trace back to another gig, which I can trace back to another gig, and then it kind of snowballs. But when I came here, I started playing salsa gigs started at 2 a.m. and went real late. You know, I'd get picked up in a van, and, Port Authority, and I'd drive to Newark with these guys I'd never met, and next thing you know, it's like 6 a.m. and it's light out, and I'm getting my $50, and then eventually I kind of graduated to doing club dates, weddings and stuff like that, and those were great. It was a great stepping stone kind of, and then I got into Broadway. It just kind of snowballed, and Broadway is, now become a very desirable gig, so it's nice to have that. And just along the way, things that were fun, just meeting people and just watching it kind of snowball. I think the more fun gigs I've done, some of them just happened by accident. Michael Lenhart got food poisoning, and his dad, Jay Lenhart, called me at 6 a.m. and said, Michael's got food poisoning. He's got a gig with Steely Dan at Garden State Arts Center. Can you show up and meet the bus at 2:00? And so I just got on the bus and went down there. And who knew that the night before you're going to be playing with Steely Dan the next night. And so that was it's kind of a life changer for me. And oddly enough, the same thing happened. I think Bill Churchville got sick, and Barry Danielian called me and said, Bill's sick, and you come down to Valley Forge and play with Tower of Power. And so I kind of got thrown into the fire with that. And even though I've only done Tower of Power once and Steely Dan maybe a handful of times, I feel like those were gigs. Those were kind of like the Sinatra gig. They were mm-hmm. things that I had always wanted to do, and it was was lucky enough to do it. And oddly enough, someone else's sickness led to both of those.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And obviously it speaks to your reputation and the fact that that's, you're the guy that people call when they, it's got to be done right now and it's with no prep. And, you know, you just come in and it's, it speaks very loudly for your, you know, incredible skill sets. Let's kind of jump a little bit. I want to move around about a few things, but one of the things I wanted to talk about, especially for listeners and trumpet players specifically, but brass players in general, you're one of the most versatile players that I know in New York. In that, you know, I mentioned it in the intro, but you know, you played with the Boston Pops. You've done, not that there's a ton of film work in New York, but you're certainly on virtually everything that comes out, which is can be more, you know, classically or legit, as we call it, oriented. But yet you'll be playing lead trumpet like we just did this weekend with Bob Minster's big band, and then go to a show. I mean, the versatility is remarkable. I was wondering if you could talk about how you approach wearing those different hats all the time, specifically with playing. I know I want to get into the writing thing in a little bit, but, sure. But just regards to with playing.
I was always into a lot of different kinds of music, so I knew fairly early on, I wasn't going to be a classical trumpet player, but I did love the music, and I love studying the scores and learning, you know, what Copland had to say, and you know, in terms of harmonically and rhythmically, and I was always into classical music, and I always wanted that to be a part of what I did, even though I knew it wasn't going to be something that I wouldn't be sitting in a symphony orchestra someday, but so I try to keep that part of my playing together. I think all my teachers probably instilled in me that, you know, when you go to New York, the more you can do, the better it'll be for you, the more you'll be able to work. So I tried to learn to play some jazz. I'm not going to go out there and play like Freddie Hubbard. I'm not going to, you know, play lead trumpet maybe like Conrad Gazzo. I'm not going to play orchestrally like Phil Smith, but I'd like to kind of approximate all those things. I call it like jack of all trades, master of none, where you have your hat in a lot of different places. So I think just kind of keeping all of those facets of your playing together on a daily basis is important. So I always start off, you know, by, you know, playing some classical literature, and then I'll put on an Ebersold record and blow some bebop, and I'll do my high note exercises to try to keep my lead playing together. It's just, I think it's more just because I love all that music that I wanted to kind of still keep it involved on some level. And the movie thing is a great point, because when you go on a movie date, you know, you don't know what you're going to get. One day it might be like symphonic classical playing, another day it might be screaming high notes, another day it might be a solo in a harmon mute or something. You just have to kind of keep the ball rolling and keep all those parts of your playing together. And I try to do that as best as I can.
Well, I beg to differ you on the master of none point, but I think you've mastered quite a few of those. But a lot of good points you made there, and I think I like the fact that you just said it gives me an idea in my own practicing. But it's like you just got to practice a little bit of all that stuff all the time to keep in shape. And another thing you said, which I think is really speaks to your overall musicality, is that you were studying scores. You know, you're looking at the Copland score and figuring out what the harmonies are, which a lot of times. For us as brass players, we kind of lose sight of that. And I know growing up, I had a really great trombone teacher named Mitchell Ross, and he would always say, don't even come in here and work on this excerpt unless you've looked at the score. And I think that speaks to exactly what you're talking about, because then you just, all of a sudden, it opens up your musical kind of mindset and what's actually going on. Let's jump ahead and talk a little bit about the extensive amount of big band work that you do. You're everybody's first call lead trumpet player. You've been a charter member of the Maria Schneider Jazz Orchestra, one of the top big bands anywhere in the world today. John Fetchock's great big band. You just recorded Ron Carter's CD, which is great. And my personal favorite, we just did it this past weekend in Pittsburgh, the great Bob Minster. You just put on a clinic back there in the lead trumpet chair and this new rhythm and blues kind of based record that Bob's putting out next spring. But kind of an extension of what you talked about with the versatility, but there's two parts of the question. One is how you approach playing with all these different bands, because stylistically, obviously, Maria is different from John, who's different from Bob, and, you know, there's that part of it. And then, more specifically, I mean, I was really blown away by the job you did this weekend, and I think Bob Minzer was as well, and everybody in the band, but how do you go about preparing for something like, you know, you're going to have, which, for those, just for clarity, we did two nights at the Manchester Craftsman's Guild in Pittsburgh, and then a live CD will come from that. So, anyway, just how do you go about preparing for something like that?
Well, the second part first, about preparing for Bob's thing. He was nice enough to send MIDI files, and, you know, they're representative, at least, of what, you know, you're going to be playing. So I just sat down there with headphones, and I put it on, and I played the stuff over and over. as you said, this particular thing was rhythm and blues oriented, so there were a lot of 16th note subdivisions and some rhythms that, you know, we as brass players aren't always accustomed to playing and reading. So I was just meticulous with spending time trying to get the rhythms together, and some of the pitches were kind of out of left field, like you have to pick off notes that might not be in the chord before it, so I tried to get those in my ear. And just like anything else, you just have to sit and spend the time doing it. And luckily, I did have enough time where I felt at least somewhat prepared when I got to Bob's thing. And I knew that we had plenty of rehearsal time. Well, not too much rehearsal time, but enough where it would make it so that I felt somewhat comfortable. But I went into it feeling okay about it. The first part of the question, the different bands and how you'd... I think that the writing often dictates the style. So like Maria writes, you know, even harmonically you can tell in her writing that it doesn't call for vibrato in many sections, whereas John Fedchak writes in maybe more of a, you know, I don't know, Woody Herman-ish style where, you know, you can put vibrato on the ends of notes. Ron Carter's thing was, you know, also kind of like John's. It was fairly straight ahead. And Bob's thing, you know, is R&B, so at least this particular record, so there's not going to be a lot of vibrato. I think the harmony will dictate how I approach a lot of it. And even volume wise, Maria, you know, most of the time doesn't require like this, you know, screaming loud volume that, you know, that John Fedchak might require in one of his charts. And, you know, and Bob Minzer, His stuff is, you know, or at least what we played this weekend, it was called for precision and like very on top of the beat and very, you know, meticulously, you know, tight short notes and stuff. And I think what, you know, most of us, when we see a chart, we can kind of tell, you know, what era it's from or what era it seems to simulate, and kind of play accordingly. So it's, again, it's like you talked about earlier with the wearing different hats with the classical and jazz and the, you know, lead playing. It's kind of the same thing with these big bands. They all have their own identifiable sound, and you kind of have to kind of get inside that. Mm-hmm. And you know, as a lead trumpet player, I guess we kind of try to approximate that as best we can.
That's a great answer, and I think you gave everybody a really great piece of advice without even meaning to, I think, because you just explained how you come in and try to adapt to musically what's going on, as opposed to maybe a more old school lead trumpet thing was, I'm coming in, I'm the guy, here's the way we're going to do it. Right. That ship has kind of sailed in terms of how to approach working and being a successful musician. And I think whether you're a lead trumpet player or third trombone or lead out, whatever it might be, adapting to the musical environment is a great piece of advice and a great point. I want to talk a little bit about, I want to talk a lot about your CD release, but before we get to that, I just want to kind of put a cap on the New York part of this. Unlike past generations who could rely pretty much on studio work in terms of getting to the top echelon of work in New York City, nowadays Broadway is a very, very important part of what we have in terms of a work pool here in New York. And I know I have a show right now, as do you, and you're moving to another one. And I'm always very grateful to have a show because it's the only kind of steady employment we can get as freelance players here in New York. And it's very satisfying in many respects because you're often around a player of Tony's caliber, and it can be a really great thing. And it can also be a little bit nerve-wracking subbing around and doing the variety of work that you have to do within Broadway. Tony, I was wondering if you could speak directly to where you see Broadway going, the importance of that in terms of your playing and your career, and like I said, where you might see that going in the next decade or so, or beyond that.
Well, I mean, Broadway itself it seems to be flourishing now. They seems like every year they're breaking attendance records and people are flocking to see shows. So I think in that way, Broadway is surviving very well. Whether we as musicians survive is another story. Each theater has a minimum, and those minimums are diminishing over time with every contract negotiation. So the bands that used to have three and four trumpets often have one or two trumpets or no trumpets now. So I think there will always be Broadway. There will always be jobs. I don't know how many jobs there will be, but it's a tough question. I'm thankful for my show, as I know you are yours. It's the kind of work where it enables you to stay on a health plan, enables you to put money in your pension, things that a lot of other gigs aren't doing for us, just by virtue of the fact that, you know, that certain people can't, you know, always contribute to the pension or go through the union. I think that Broadway, again, will always be there, whether it employs 30 trumpet players or it employs 10 trumpet players remains to be seen. But right now, it seems to be doing very well. And I find that just playing on I shouldn't say this, I'm a terrible practicer. Mm. I'm not really good at, like, maintaining every day. Like, if I have something to work up to, I'll practice. But if I don't have to play, you know, anything hard for a few days and I have a day off, I'm probably not touching my horn, which is... I don't know if that's good or bad, but what Broadway also does is it makes me play every day. It makes me keep in shape. I know in times when I've been between shows for a few months, and there's a day I don't have anything going on, or 2 days I just won't touch it, and Broadway makes me kind of have to keep my chops together. And mm-hmm. and the shows, again, as the orchestras get smaller, the parts get more demanding. So. You know, whereas if, you know, you might have a lot of rest because there was a big orchestra, now you might be playing for two or three people, or what was two or three people in the past. So now you're switching from cup mute to harmon mute or flugelhorn, and the arrangers are trying to, like, you know, make the orchestra sound bigger than it actually is, and so your job gets harder. So there's really no slacking off when you have a show. So in that way, in addition to financially, I'm very grateful for it. Mm-hmm.
That's a great point, and something we don't always think about, but, you know, you're looking at your book and playing, and your chops are getting tired, and you're realizing now you actually are playing for two or three players. I mean, I'm at Pippin right now, and the Pippin in the 70s had two or three trombones. Now it's just one, so yes, makes a very good point. So, and also all the things that you said as well, I thought were really important, that, like, you know, we don't think of it as musicians. We get this mindset that it's all about the music, and of course it is, but at the end of the day, a health plan and pension, all those things are really important. So I appreciate you mentioning that. I want to shift over to something that I'm really proud that I'm a part of it. And I think Tony did a remarkable job on this CD. And for those of you who don't have it, you should run out and get this and go to his website, tonycavlik.com, and check it out. It's really a remarkable CD. It's called Around the Horn, and it was recorded about a year ago. Recently released, and first of all, congratulations on
Thank
the
you.
Amazing job that you did. And the thing that kind of took me by surprise, I knew that Tony was a really good arranger, but I think a lot of us were not as aware of your arranging talents as we should have been. But we had the pleasure of spending a couple of days recording this with an all-star band in New York, and I just wanted you to maybe talk at length about, you know, what that experience was like for you, putting it together, writing. You obviously have a great deal of talent as a writer, but a lot of passion in what you do as well. So just anything you'd like to share with us about the whole process.
Sure, thank you. Well, first of all, you guys sounded amazing. And as a writer, the writer part of me anyway, appreciates so much when you put paper down on the music stand and you guys, like, make it, you know, come to life. It's beautiful. which, you know, I'm forever grateful for you guys, to you guys. But I'd always wanted to do a big band record, and you know, it's big band records are expensive. There's a lot of people. I didn't have a record company backing me, so it was kind of all out of my own pocket. So it's something I'd always wanted to do. I've been saving up for it for a long time, and I have maybe 40 charts, and I picked 10 that I thought would be most appropriate, and just, you know, the planning stages were very slow, like anything. It takes a long time. Writing the music, calling the guys, having the guys play the music, that's the easy part. All the other stuff is not so easy. The, you know, getting CD artwork, promotional stuff, who's going to cater the session, you know, like there's a lot that goes into it that I, you know, honestly, I'd never even considered. I just figured, oh, I'll just make a record. It'll be fun. Mm-hmm. And it was fun, but then there were parts that were less fun. But honestly, it was, it sounds like cliche, but it's a dream come true for me to hear, you know, the people that I'd always wanted to have play on the session. I think almost everyone that I called initially was able to do it. So I kind of almost got all of my first call people, which is great. And I think we spent 2 days there doing it, and it was, again, incredibly stressful, but incredibly rewarding too. You know, you learn a lot about yourself when you know, anytime you hear yourself play, you know, you're always judging and trying to, you know, critique and, oh, I could have done this better, that better. And it's even more so for me with writing. Like, I listen to these arrangements and I'm thinking, oh, this is good, but what if I had done this or done that? So you're constantly, you know, learning, which is a positive. But I felt like it was a very good representation of those charts, and it was a really fun time for me. And I'm looking forward to saving up for the next one. You
know, well, that's good.
Might be a minute.
Good news for all of us, and thank you for the compliment. But I have to say that unless charts are, as we all know as musicians, unless the material is well written, you can have the greatest players in the world, and it's not going to sound good unless the material is there. So that was that's on you. You did a phenomenal job. In terms of influences, writing wise, to me, I hear a few. I mean, certainly Bob Minter is one that I hear in your writing. Yep. Thad Jones comes to mind as you pull. Are there any that jump out at you that you really feel like are the major influences?
Yeah. Well, I've ripped off all the masters. I've tried to anyway. No, I love Bob Minter. I love Maria's writing. It's so beautiful. John Fetchuk, Mike Holliber, John Hollenbeck, and a lot of people that I don't even think that I write like, but that have influenced me, all those writers. I'm a big fan of like guys like Rob Mouncey, Vince Mendoza, Don Sebesky, and there's a million great writers. But writing for big band is something I've always enjoyed, and I started in middle school actually, and I'm sure it was a pretty subpar experience for the rest of the middle schoolers that had to play it, but I've always enjoyed writing, and now it's kind of easier than ever. Like it used to be, even, you know, when I was in college, you'd write and then you weren't sure what it sounded like until you brought it in and put it in front of the cats and they played it. Now it's like you have Sibelius or, you know, some sequencing thing. It just spits spits it right back at you, so you can kind of hear what's going on, but even within the confines of that, you don't really know until you put it on the stand and, mm-hmm. and hear it done. But I've, you know, I'm a fan of almost every big band. I try to listen to as much as I can in terms mm-hmm. of big band and writing. And if there's a voicing that I really enjoy, I'll check that out. Or if there's a, you know, superimposing or a combination of this instrument and that instrument, I'll, you know, you can read all the books you want about orchestration, and a lot of them are very good, but I think until you experiment and just kind of hear it, you don't really know exactly what you're going to get. Mm-hmm. So a lot of it is experimentation. You know, I can't tell you how many times I've written a chart and rewritten it and rewritten it and changed this and changed that. And you know, the record comes out and I'm like, I'm still second guessing myself, but that's how we learn, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's good to, well said. I mean, I think it's an all constantly evolving process, becoming a good writer. Tony, let's switch hats yet again and talk a little bit about your teaching side of your career. Mm-hmm. I know you just took over the position at Manhattan School of Music this year, which I think it's got to be a good feeling having been a student there, and now you're one of the top trumpet teachers. And you've also been at Montclair State, I believe, for many years. Yeah. But you can talk a little bit about your experience in that regard and how you find the students that you're working with and all those kinds of things.
Yeah. I have to say, when I was in college myself, I thought I would never teach. I said, I don't want to teach. I want to play. And then it's funny because as life goes on, you know, what you enjoy changes. And now I'm like, I can't teach enough. I love it. I've been at Montclair for about 11 years now. And again, my first year at Manhattan, as you said, and the kids are great. And what I find especially rewarding about teaching is not only that you're seeing progress in students, but also that you kind of have to practice what you preach. You go in every week and you say, well, do this. And it's, well, okay, can you demonstrate that for me? And it's like, you better be able to do it because you're telling them to do it, so you have to do it. So I've learned, again, a lot about myself and what I should be practicing just by, you know, saying to the kids, play this, do this. And, you know, even if it's, you know, in the back of your mind, you're like, yeah, I'll get to that someday. But, you know, when you're telling a kid every week, no, you have to do this, then it's like right in the forefront of your mind. And it's like, start thinking, well, I guess I should do that too. The kids are very talented. I feel like I'm a decent teacher with kids who are very interested in learning. I'm probably not as good a teacher with, like, beginners. So I'm glad to be teaching at the college level. The level at some of my students is remarkable. Mm. And I keep thinking, you know, wow, what are these guys going to do in 10 years? And I'm sure there's a couple guys that I think will be household names. Mm. And I'm not sure how they're going to make their mark or in what area they're going to make their mark, but you're going to hear from them. And it's for me, it's an honor just to sit there and try to, you know, tell them something about what I've been doing and for them to appreciate it. Mm-hmm. So it's been great. I love teaching. I really do. I'm sorry that I didn't get a master's, actually.
Yeah. Oh, that's great. And I know you were kind enough to work with my youngest son, Zach, and he got just a ton out of it. So I think your teaching speaks for itself. That's great. I want to play just a little bit. We do this in some of the interviews of name association, just throwing out a couple names that are going to put a smile on your face and just give me your real quick thoughts about when you hear these great artists and what in this case they're all trumpet players, but what's kind of the first couple of thoughts that you might have? Let's start with one of, I know we talk about him all the time, he's everybody's favorite, but let's talk about the great Chuck Finley.
Oh, well, I mean, we've been hearing him on records forever, you and I did a gig years and years ago with the Tonight Show Band with Doc in Atlantic City, and Chuck came out, and Snooki came out, and Ed Shaughnessy, and a couple of people from L.A., and then they augmented the band in New York, and I remember just, you know, we were just giggling, like, listening to Chuck Finley play, like, the fire he plays with, and the passion, he just, like, there's certain people that when you play, you're thinking, that guy loves music. Mm-hmm. And that's mm-hmm. every time I hear Chuck Finley play, I think that guy loves music. He really, he just, like, everything he does has this passion to it. It's beautiful. And he's a beautiful human being, and I you know him well as well. And he's a wonderful trumpet player. And I don't know. I he's one of the guys that I definitely try to emulate when I play. That intensity when he plays, it's beautiful.
I feel exactly, echo your thoughts exactly. Another great trumpet player, also this based in New York, but Bob Millikan.
Yeah. Bob might be one of the funniest human beings ever. He was my idol when I moved to New York, you know, because I had heard him on a bunch of recordings as well. Then I finally got to meet him. I was very nervous, and he was, you know, he would immediately crack a joke and, you know, put you at ease. Consummate professional, and I think maybe one of the most important parts of Bob is that, like, when you're on a recording session and things are getting tense and we're behind schedule and everyone's uptight, Bob has this ability to, like, say five words and just break up the room and just diffuse all that tension. And it doesn't go unnoticed by me that, like, that, you know, he's doing that by design, because mm-hmm. people are getting uptight and people are getting nervous, and so Bob just, you know, he could just throw a one-liner out there and crack everyone up, and his playing obviously is, you know, of the highest level. He's mm-hmm. he's been, you know, he's Broadway royalty, really, in mm-hmm. terms of mm-hmm. You know, what he's done in his career.
Yeah,
it's phenomenal.
It's a great point. Bob has that rare ability to not only play great, but he's got the personality that just makes the session go well, or the show go well.
Yeah.
This next person, sadly, we've lost her, but on the other hand, she's left behind an incredible legacy, and I know you've worked with her extensively, and now you've taken over her position at Manhattan School of Music, but just your thoughts about the late, great Lori Frank.
Again, the sweetest person around. Loved music, maybe one of the most generous people I know. Just, you know, I know that she would teach kids, you know, for free if they didn't have the money. She was incredibly passionate about her teaching, and maybe the most daunting thing about me teaching in Manhattan is knowing that some of these kids had studied with Lori, and she completely had her stuff together. And I'm thinking, I can't help but think in the back of my mind, they're thinking, well, come on, Cadillac, get your stuff together. Just Lori certainly had her stuff together. Super sweet human being. She's helped me personally and musically for many years. She's always there. If I was bummed out or whatever, she'd always, like, know right what to say to pick you up. And, in terms of pedagogy, I mean, she's written books, and, you know, Flexus is one of the finest warm-up books out there with her and John mm-hmm. McNeil. I'll never forget the first time I heard her play. We were playing in Lauren Schoenberg's band, and we were playing this chart called Stealin' Apples, as Benny Goodman. And she pasted a high E at the end. And it was just like, you know, it was great. And then we had to play, like, just a D and the staff together in unison. And she said, and she could tell I was very nervous. And it was like, the great Lori Frank was here. And she said, yeah, good pitch, right down the middle. Great. You know, she was very encouraging. When I was in college at NEC, we used to drive down to hear her play with Ed Palermo with 7th Avenue South. Mm. She played lead. She had the big afro at the time.
Right.
Great, great lady.
That's awesome. Yeah. And we'll round up this with a name that always puts a smile on your face. And we had the good fortune to work with him last week. But he's a legend as a trumpet player, as a musician, as a person. But the great Lou Soloff.
Oh, he's, again, a very, very, you know, dear friend. I studied with Lou at Manhattan from 1986 to 1989, and he was really generous. He would take me on some jingles and stuff and just show me the, you know, hey, come meet me at the studio. Well, you know, I'll take you in. Well, you know, you can sit in the corner and give you some headphones. And I had never been on a session, really, and he was really helpful and very, very generous that way. And he was when we spoke earlier about like wearing a lot of different hats and keeping the classical thing and the jazz thing. He was really instrumental for me in saying, you know, keep this together, you know. I'd play some excerpts for him, and then I'd play some, you know, jazz things for him. And he was really, really good at saying, you know, just keep all those balls in the air, because you'll need those someday. And he was right. He's a complete character, and every, you know, as you say, the smile on my face. I mean, he never ceases to crack me up, and he's a very sweet, giving individual, and a wonderful trumpet player. And my parents actually had the LP of, you know spinning Wheel, the solo, and I heard it when I was a little kid, and I was like, someday I want to meet that guy. And sure enough, you know,
that's great stuff. I think Lou too, like, he's just he's an inspiration, and you know, we were talking before the interview, he's turned 70 years old this year, and he's out there playing in clubs and doing it all, and it's like, it's inspiring for all of us. Tony, as we wind down today, I always like to kind of finish up with asking great artists like yourself that have been fortunate to talk to, and I get a lot out of this myself. I used to say it was just for the younger viewers that we met, but it's for everybody. But If you had a piece of advice that you would give for, in this case, maybe a young trumpet player out there, but maybe it could be for anybody, but in this, like I said, in this case, for a young trumpet player who's thinking of going into the profession of music, and maybe if you can capsulize what you'd say to them to get them on the right path, what might that be?
Wow. Well, I think, you know, alluding to what we, again, talked about earlier, wear as many hats as you can. Keep your classical thing together, keep your jazz thing together, get your lead thing together, whatever, you know, as many things as you can, as many tools as you can have, you'll be working a lot more if you have a lot of those tools. Learn Sibelius or Finale, a notation program. Learn Pro Tools or Logic or some sort of sequence, software sequencing. Have all that stuff together. Be able to teach, be able to play a church gig. Just have it all, have as much at your disposal as possible, because the work now is all, it's all scattered. And the days of, like, as we've talked about, coming in and, you know, just playing studio work are long gone. So the more you can do, the better off you are. And I think the most important piece of advice is, especially in a town like New York or a big city, everybody plays good. That's a given. Like, you know, there's a million great players. You could throw a baseball on 8th Avenue and hit like seven burning tenor players. I mean, so be a nice person. Like, there's plenty of people out there who play good who don't work because they're not cool. They're not fun to be around. Their egos are too big. Whatever. Just be nice. You know, life's too short to not be. Not be a good person.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's great advice for all of us. Well, Tony, listen, thank you so much for taking time out of your schedule. And really, I just loved it. It was great hearing all the things you had to say and the passion that you bring to music. For those of you who don't have it, like I said, check out Around the Horn, Tony Cadlick Big Band, great CD. And we will look forward to following all the many, many projects you're going to be involved with in the decades ahead. So.
Thanks. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Tony.
Thank you, Mark. Appreciate
it. We will see everybody next time on Bone to Pick.